Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. Good morning, and thank you again for joining us today. Just a few reminders before we get started. This session is being recorded, so I ask that everyone remain muted. Questions for our presenter will be submitted in the chat box, and due to time limitations, we may not be able to answer all your questions during the presentation, but we will follow up with any answers to any questions we did not answer afterwards. I'd like to introduce Mr. Rich Coffel, the Director for Veterans Business Opportunity Center. Rich is the director for the Veterans Business Outreach Center, where he helps veterans who want to start or expand their business. Rich counsels veterans, assists with business and marketing plans, and other aspects of business planning and startup. He also travels throughout the state performing workshops and counseling sessions. Rich has been the Veterans Business Advisor prior to assuming the role of director. He comes from DVS, from the New Mexico Workforce Connection, where he was a Disabled Veteran Outreach Program Specialist and a local Veterans Employment Representative. The Gary, Indiana native served 26 years in the U.S. Air Force and was a combat veteran of the Vietnam War. He served over 18 years in the Pacific Theater of Operations, with part of his career being in the special operations community. Rich has an MBA from the University of Phoenix and has owned his business in Japan and two in New Mexico, as well as managed a business for his wife. Without further ado, I'd like to welcome Mr. Rich Coffel.
Well, good morning and thank you. First, I gotta thank Terry McDermott for putting up with my slide deck changes, and my brother-in-arms and good friend, Rick Lopez, for recommending me to do this presentation this morning. So if you'd like the next slide, please. The VBOC is actually a federally mandated program. It was created by public law in 2010. Congress saw a need to assist veterans that wanted to start or grow businesses. So we started with 14. Actually, the one here in New Mexico was created by our DVS secretary at the time, Mr. John Garcia. And the SBA liked the program so much that they adopted it. Today, we have 22 VBOCs, and each one of us carries our own territory. The grantee is the New Mexico Department of Veterans Services, where I'm employed. And we have a staff of three: myself, my business advisor, Jim Cassidy, and my business operations specialist, Kim Posey. Next slide, please. The Outreach Center is a one-stop shop for the transitioning service members, veterans, National Guard, reserve members, and eligible military spouses who either want to start a business or grow a business or purchase a business, just about every aspect of business. Next slide, please. Our area of responsibility is the entire state of New Mexico and Colorado. In addition, we cover 8 military installations between the two states. Next slide. Our primary focus is entrepreneurial training. We do what's called the Boots to Business or the Boots to Business Reboot classes. Boots to Business is done on a military installation for the transitioning service member and their spouses. And the Boots to Business Reboot is actually done off the military installation. And we only do a handful of those a year. But we cover 8 different modules in our training. We talk about what it is to be an entrepreneur. Do you have what it really takes to start a business? Do you understand markets and marketing? We also teach economics. We talk about the legal entities. For example, you know, sole proprietorship, limited liability companies, S-corps, C-corps, B-corps. We also talk about the different avenues to get in financing. And then we have what's called our next steps, which moves into business planning. Then moving forward is actually talking about our partners. Next slide, please. We also just recently signed a contract with a company called Govology. They specialize in government contracting training. Normally, when it comes to government contracting of any type, federal, state, local, we refer over to the Procurement Technical Assistance Center, who are one of our partners under the SBA. And a couple of years ago, I had the privilege of being in Washington, D.C. for my annual conference when our administrator and folks from the USDA signed an MOU making us partners. Next slide, please. So in our training, when we're talking about our partners, I normally have one of my USDA counterparts come in and do the presentation. I work very closely with Rick Lopez and Carlos Contreras. We've developed a really strong working relationship and a great referral program. When it comes to veterans wanting to getting into farming and ranching, first thing I do is I look at Rick and Carlos and find out which one of them can help them the most. Since most of my veterans are in rural communities, they oftentimes are looking at rural funding, rural programs. And that's when I contact Carlos to sit down and talk to him about what's available to him. This is one of the slides that we go over with our veterans during the training program. Next slide, please. And we talk about what the USDA offers, loans and loan guarantees, processing and marketing of products, and energy efficient improvements. And I've actually got some veterans that have reached out to the USDA. They've worked closely with Rick or Carlos and really got superior service. Next slide, please. And we go into it if any event that with COVID going on right now, Rick and Carlos are a little limited in their traveling. In fact, we just started traveling ourselves. So when they're not available, we talk to the students about startup costs, business acquisition, purchase and development of land, buildings, or facilities. We talk about equipment, machinery, supplies, or inventory, and how the USDA can help in business conversion, enlargement, repair, or modernization of their facilities. Next slide, please. We also talk about the processing and marketing of their products, how the USDA assists in agricultural producers in funding value-added activities related to the processing and or marketing of new products, how they support generation of new products, how they help to expand marketing opportunities and increase producer income. Next slide, please. We talk about the funds that are available for different necessities, such as insulation, lighting, electric or solar power, cooling or refrigerating units. We talk about the small and large wind generation programs. We talk about small and large solar generation. We also talk about replacement of energy inefficient equipment and efficiency heating and air conditioning systems, HVAC. Next slide, please. And then we give them this website to go to get further information. And then what I normally do, I'll send an email to Rick or Carlos, depending on what area we're looking at. If it's farming and ranching, I'll send it to Rick. If it's for rural, then I refer more to Carlos and do a slight, you know, a small introduction of the client to my USDA counterparts. Next slide, please. We also do counseling. We're kind of like the first step in the SBA process. We'll sit them down and ask them, is entrepreneurship really for you? What makes you think that you can be successful starting this type of business? For example, I had a veteran came to me and he wanted to start a restaurant. And I said, okay, let's look at where restaurants are today during the COVID period. How successful are they? How many are open? How many across the nation have closed? We don't try to dissuade them. We just try and provide them with enough information to make a sound decision. We also want to find out if they're a risk taker. Oftentimes in training, I'll ask the question, how many of you are combat veterans? And I'll get a smattering of hands go up and I'll ask them, well, who are the risk takers? And invariably, every single combat veteran will stick their hand up in the air. And that's when I break the news to them that being a risk taker in combat is totally different than being a risk taker in business. It's two different types of risk. We also want to find out, are they a self-starter? Are you the type that's going to actually get out there and do your research, do your homework, look at every option that's available to you? Or are you going to sit back and wait for somebody to come to you? One of the first questions I get asked a lot of times are, where are the grants? According to the SBA, in business, there's no such thing as a grant. Now, there are some very limited grants, and I know the USDA has some, but according to the SBA, our standard answer is, sorry, we don't have grants. So we talk about how well organized are you? How do you get along with different types of personalities? How are you going to handle a disgruntled customer? And are you a positive thinker? Next slide, please. Then we sit down and determine the feasibility of your idea. Why do you want to start a business? Sometimes I'll have veterans come to me and say, well, I can't find a job. I want to start a business. Well, since I have a background in Department of Labor, that's when I start looking at, well, what is the reason you can't find a job? Is it you can't interview? You don't know how to write a good resume? If you have a problem with a resume, we're going to have another problem with a business plan. So we go through what kind of business you want to start. Have you done any market research on the area you want to go into? Is there a benefit to starting this business? We also want to know who your competitors are. This will also help us understand, have you done any research yet? And is there a need for this business? In our Boots of Business training, there's a video clip we show of a marketing expert who was with Macintosh Computers by the name of Guy Kawasaki. And one of the things he will tell you is, if you're offering a product or service that nobody wants, nobody's willing to pay for, and there's nobody else doing it, and you still want to do it, you fit the category of probably stupid. For lack of a better way of putting it, it's not a wise idea if you have no competition, nobody wants it, nobody's going to pay for it. Next slide, please. So we talk about, is it a true business idea or a business concept? I oftentimes will use the example of Alexander Majors and Samuel B. Morris. Alexander Majors created the Pony Express. He didn't take into consideration all the barriers he had to face as he moved his messages from Missouri to California. Samuel B. Morris, on the other hand, was pretty smart. He knew the railroad was building its railroad from Missouri to California. He convinced them if they would put up poles for him, he would string the wire. Well, when you think of both of them had a good business idea, but Samuel B. Morris actually had the true business concept. The Pony Express only lasted 18 months. Samuel B. Morris's Morris code is still used today in emergency situations. Next slide, please. So then we go through, once we've ascertained that it's feasible and it's a good idea, and you've already started doing some research and you understand how to do research, we go into some of the other things like, what are you going to name your business? And we explain to you how to find if you can use that name within your state by going to the Secretary of State's office. Then we sit and discuss with you. And before we discuss it, We have to add the caveat that we are not attorneys. Therefore, we cannot give you legal advice. We can only explain the different types of legal structure. And we'll go through all the different legal structures with them. Next slide, please. Once we've done that, then we talk about how to register your business. You register with the Secretary of State's office as one of the legal entities you choose. Then you go to tax and revenue and register for your gross receipt taxes. Depending on what city or municipality or county you're in, they may have a requirement for a business permit. You'll be responsible for checking on that. We next talk about the employer's identification number. I can't tell you how many veterans or clients I've had that have paid somebody to do this for them. You go to irs.gov on the website, takes you less than 5 minutes to register, and it's free. I actually had a partnership that paid $1,500 to do this. Next slide, please. Then we talk about methods of financing. For example, bootstrapping. Bootstrapping is basically paying for it yourself. It all comes out of your own pocket. Or we talk about microlenders, which we have three of here in New Mexico. And we also have two up in Colorado. We talk about the pros and cons of using microlenders, angel investors, crowdfunding, and banks. We also make the customer aware that banks don't loan to startups. They may loan to you if you're purchasing an existing business. They may loan to you if you're purchasing a franchise. But if you're a startup right out of the chute, 99% of the time, a bank is not going to talk to you. They want you to be in business at least 2 years. Another consideration, if you're using angel investors, keep in mind, if you want full control of your business, you're going to give some of that control up to get an angel investor. Now, oftentimes we'll tell them to sit down and watch a couple episodes of Shark Tank so they can get an understanding, because they're basically angel investors. Next slide, please. Then we get into the real weeds here when we start talking about research. One of the things we explain to them during the Boost Business, if there's two things you learn during that 8 modules of training, is research and opportunity. Look for an opportunity to be successful in business, but to research. You research every single day. I have a software program that the SBA furnishes me with. It's called IBIS World. IBIS World is a fantastic marketing tool. It can give you the past history of the industry you want to go into. It can tell you at a very scientific evaluation of what the future looks like for that industry. It can tell you what risks are associated with that industry. It can also tell you if you're going into something huge, who your major competitors are. It also gives us a very detailed report, which we'll sit down and go over with the client. It can be anywhere from 35 to 50 pages of very detailed information.
Hey, puppy dog.
Somebody's dog is happy. Next slide, please. We also talk about franchising. The pluses and minuses of franchises. It comes with a lot of benefits. You already have a business plan developed. It's a lot easier to get financing. But you also want to research whatever it is you're going to get your franchise in. For example, I had one veteran that was getting ready to sign the papers for a hamburger franchise. Well, when I sat her down and asked her, have you thoroughly researched this? And she told me, yes, we did a little bit more research together and found out they don't supply anybody west of the Mississippi River. So it wouldn't behoove her to open a franchise out here because they're not going to support it. You can also go to the Federal Trade Commission and research franchises. And you can also go to VetFran. They will tell you which are veteran-friendly franchises. Some actually waive their entry fees. Next slide, please. So the largest purchaser of goods in the United States is the federal government. I'll always get people to tell me, I want to be a contractor. Well, that's fine. But first you have to start a business. So we have to go through all these other steps till we get them to this. So if they want to become a federal contractor, they need to register in SAMS, or it's actually Beta SAM now. If they want to contract with the VA, then it's a total different certification. The state of New Mexico, it's another certification. So what we do is we refer over to our partners at the Procurement Technical Assistance Center. They're the specialists in contracting as far as registration, as far as all the ins and outs of contracting. They're very, very thorough, and their services are also free. Next slide, please. Referrals. We do a ton of referrals. When it comes time for the veteran to write that business plan, now it's to go to the next rung in the ladder. So we refer them over to the small business development centers. They're also under the SBA. They're our partners. They're funded the same as the VBOC under a federal grant. Certification of as a veteran-owned government owned business or government contracting, again, we send them PTAC. Once they've got the business started, the business plan developed, they've got their financing in hand, now they need mentorship. Now's when we refer more to our partners at SCORE. For those that don't know, SCORE is actually an organization of retired business professionals who were very successful in their business lives and have now volunteered to act as mentors. In the state of New Mexico, we actually have 99 mentors. We also, when it comes to farming and ranching, again, as I said earlier, farming and ranching, I call my buddy Rick. If it's rural development, I reach out to Carlos. And if it's, there's also another organization called West. West is actually the Women's Business Center. They also assist with business plans and financial lending. They're a small micro lender. They cap their loans at $10,000, but they're another member of the SBA partners. Next slide, please. We also do a lot of outreach. Prior to COVID, we had a program called VBOC on the Road, where we visit every community in New Mexico, do about a 45-minute presentation on what we do, what we offer, who we are, and who we work with. Several years ago, we went before the tribal governors and offered to do what we called VBOC on the res. We got their blessing to use that terminology. And we visited several of the pueblos and reservations. But again, with COVID, that's on a hold. We do benefit fairs. We do anything that's sponsored by Department of Veterans Services. I work very closely with the New Mexico and Colorado district offices, and we also attend national conferences. Next slide, please. So finally, I want to thank all of you that have served for your serving and all those that have supported the veteran community for doing so. If you click it one more time, it should bring up my favorite guy, the Eagle. And that concludes my briefing. If there's any questions, I'd be happy to try and answer them.
Hey, Richard, this is Rick Lopez. I'm going to jump on here real quick, if I may. I want to thank you so much for coming on board and supporting our cause here with this OPPE Summit. Your role is so vital. And I want to mention to the veterans that are out there, if you are looking at starting a business, if you're looking at getting in farming and ranching, reach out to Richard Coffel and the VBOC, because there are so many programs that you will be billed for at great length and at great expense that are offered free. Richard Coffel has put together a second to none relationship with stakeholders that he will get you to the people that you need to be successful in business. Richard, again, I want to thank you. It's always been a pleasure to serve with you throughout these years, and your wealth of knowledge is definitely beneficial to all veterans who want to get into small business. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Rick. I sure appreciate the support that you and Carlos, and I've worked with Ray Melton. I really appreciate being able to have a good working relationship and a friendship.
We do have a couple minutes for question and answer if anybody would like to submit a question in the chat box. But we do have a few minutes before we have to break and head into the main session.
I'm a little fast, Ruby.
No, you did really well. Thank you for keeping us on time. I actually appreciate it very much.
I will address something real quick, Richard, that you had mentioned, and that was about grants. The SBA doesn't offer grants. Most of our grants are on our different programs. And what they're based on is your organization, can you in fact put together a program to help educate the people on what's being offered by the USDA? So one of the big misinformations that gets passed out there is that there's specific grants for veterans. And that's just not the case. But what the USDA offers is they offer an awful lot of waivers. They offer waivers for experience. They are give opportunities for instead of an 80% cost share program, it's a 90% cost share program. So again, the government pays 90%, you pay 10%. There's a lot of great programs out there for veterans, but we want a little bit of skin in the game on your part as well. And so I encourage you veterans to either reach out to your USDA service agencies or reach out to Richard Coffel and the VBOC, because they just do absolutely great things. And he will, I'll say it again, he will put you in touch with the right people.
Okay, if there's no other questions, thank you again, Rich. Thank you for your service and thank you for your presentation. You are doing great work to help our veterans who want to start a small business or go into farming and ranching. And thank you for working with USDA and our partners in New Mexico to help our veterans.